Welcome to AFM class, given by the UC Berkeley Marvell Nanofabrication Lab. In this course, we will discuss some basics of the theory of atomic force microscopy, as well as some operational details of the Park Systems AFM at UC Berkeley. Let's first orient AFM with other microscopy techniques. Depending on the lens, optical microscopes can resolve features perhaps as small as half a micron. Stylus-based profilers are limited by the size of the stylus, but typically resolve features in the 5 to 10 micron range. Thermal emission SEMs can resolve features down to approximately 100 nanometers, and field emission SEMs resolve down to 10 nanometers. Nanolab's SEMs are both field emission SEMs. The lateral resolution of an AFM depends on the probe chosen for the measurement, but can be as small as a few nanometers. Z resolution is measured in picometers. The only technique with consistently higher resolution than AFM is TEM. The trade-off with this high resolution is a limitation on the maximum scale of the measurement. The Park AFM cannot measure a step taller than 7.5 microns, and the imageable area is only 100 by 100 microns square. Other microscopy tools in Nanolab are capable of measuring taller steps and have larger fields of view. Keep this in mind when thinking about which microscopy tool is best for your measurement, and remember that multiple measurements may be necessary to give the full view of a device. Let's turn to some AFM specifics. The hardware components of an AFM consist of a Z scanner, a probe, and an XY scanner. The sample is mounted on the XY scanner moving side to side. The Z scanner is in a feedback loop. A laser reflects off the probe to the PSPD, the position-sensitive photo detector. The signal from the PSPD feeds back to the Z scanner to control the Z piezo. The software will handle much of this feedback loop. Your job is to make sure the laser signal is correctly aligned on the probe and PSPD. The AFM probe is probably the single most important component in an AFM measurement. Probe refers to the entire assembly. Support chip is the largest part of the probe assembly. The cantilever is the narrow bar jutting out, and the tip is the actual part of the probe that touches the sample. Note in this SEM image that the tip is not at the very end of the cantilever. To actually make a measurement, the tip will approach the sample surface. There are two main measurement modes, contact and non-contact. In contact mode, the tip is dragged across the sample surface. Topography is measured as deflections on the photodetector. If you wanted to measure actual atoms with an AFM, you would use a contact measurement. However, those types of measurements aren't possible with our setup in Nanolab. There's too much noise from foot traffic, airflow, etc., to measure atoms on our tool. The downside of using contact mode is that this mode will wear down tips and increase the likelihood of picking up a stray particle more quickly than a non-contact mode. Because of this wear, non-contact modes are the default modes on all modern AFMs. In a non-contact measurement, the tip is oscillated very quickly. Non-contact tips are stiffer than contact tips and act more like springs. They have a resonant frequency. As the tip comes close to the sample, van der Waals forces cause deflection, which will feed back to the Z piezo and map out the topography. Because the tip is oscillating, it has less interaction with the sample, and there will be less overall wear. This is why non-contact measurements are generally preferred over contact measurements. There are actually two non-contact modes on the Park AFM, tapping and non-contact. These are very similar, with slightly different resonant frequency offsets. Non-contact mode is able to keep the tip slightly further away from the sample, which minimizes tip damage, so this is the default imaging mode. There are additional types of measurements that can be made on the AFM. We'll return to these modes later in this presentation. For now, let's discuss basic operation of the tool in non-contact mode. Let's begin by exchanging a probe. we're going to watch a video of this happening at the tool. In the video, you'll see the following steps. Unlock the scan head. Slide the scan head to the right. Place the scan head in its holder. Install a probe. Slide the scan head back into its dovetail groove and lock the scan head. When you're ready to put a new tip on the tool, you need to first unlock the scan head. Push the tabs in, elephant ears in, and then take the scan head and slide it to the right. It should come easily. If not, change the angle of your hands. Don't force it. Turn it over and put it in the scan head holder. Now you're ready to grab one of the cantilever chips. They're stored face down in the box. When you pick it up, turn it so that the cantilever is facing you. Go ahead and put that on the tool. It's held magnetically in place. The two alignment tabs should fit in the slot and the hole. Now you're ready to put the scan head back on the tool. Pick it up, turn it over. Now, fit it back into its dovetail groove. It should slide easily. If it doesn't, adjust your hands and try again. There. Now, keep going until it clicks into place. And then lock it into place. Elephant ears out. To align the laser, there are three sets of adjustment knobs to use, and you'll move from the top set of adjustment knobs down. First, verify the laser is on. Then, adjust the camera so the cantilever is centered. Adjust the laser so that it is correctly aligned. And adjust the PSPD to center the beam in the detector. Now that we've put the cantilever tip on the scan head and the scan head in the tool, we're ready to align the laser to the end of the cantilever. The first thing we have to do is get the end of the laser centered in the camera view. We're going to use these two knobs to adjust the camera. I want to have the end of the cantilever centered in those white guides. Now the tip itself is not actually at the end of these PPP NCHR tips. It's actually a little bit further back, kind of where the triangle part of that narrow cantilever ends. There, that's about where I want to have the cantilever centered. Now, I'm going to turn this knob and this knob to get the laser aligned above the tip. I need to find my laser first. If I move it up and down, I should be able to get laser light to reflect off onto the wide mount of the cantilever. Then I can move it left to right until I have it centered over the narrow part of the cantilever tip. Then I'll move it down until I have it approximately over the guide. If I move it down too far, I'm going to lose intensity and I'm going to have a noisier measurement. So let me move it back up a little. Now that I have the laser light approximately where I want it, I'm going to use these two knobs to center that laser on my photodetector. One goes up and down, and the other goes left to right. I adjust them until my laser light is centered in the detector and the circle turns green. And that's how I adjust the laser. In the previous video, it was difficult to see the laser as it moved down the cantilever. Let's examine this more closely. The cartoon shows a laser spot at four potential points along the cantilever. The intensity of the laser light decreases as you move down the cantilever, whereas the magnitude of the oscillations increases as you move down it. The optimal laser point is around point C. The intensity is still quite high, and the oscillation amplitude is also sufficient for good measurements. Now that the probe is installed and the laser is aligned, you can start making the measurement. First, load your sample, securing it either with the stage vacuum or the magnetic sample holder. Then, move the stage until the sample is below the scan head. Make sure that the probe is above the sample. Once you hit the position button, the probe will approach your sample. If you are not above your sample, you risk damage to the tool. hit the position button to tune the probe and approach the surface. After the approach, the scan head will lift and you can find the feature you want to image. At this point, the tip will be 100 microns above the sample. The next step is to actually image the sample surface. Here, the final approach is performed, and the tip generally ends a few nanometers above the sample. While imaging, you should monitor the scan to get good tracking. When taking an image, the scanner will move forward and backward, getting two traces for each scan line. Good tracking means that the forward and backward traces match well. When the tool isn't tracking well, there will be discrepancies between the forward and backward scans. When this happens, you might need to reduce the scan speed, lower the probe set point, or even exchange the probe. The Park AFM has two modes, manual mode and auto mode. Auto mode has four simple steps: setup, position, image, and end. While manual mode has a lot of control. You actually have access to those four buttons on the manual control page, but you may operate the tool from either tab. Here we're providing a list of good settings to get started. The Nanolab office stocks one type of tip, the PPP-NCHR tip. NCHR stands for non-contact, highly reflective, and you'll find these tips listed as NCHR in the software. If your project needs a different type of tip, please plan ahead when ordering, as they can take a few weeks to arrive. NCHR tips should have laser intensity between 2.5 and 3 volts when correctly aligned. Start your scan with a scan resolution around 256 or 512 pixels. We also recommend running in adaptive mode. In this mode, the tool will determine the scan speed by comparing the forward and backward traces to try to get good tracking. It's also important to change the file name and directory before you start imaging. The tool automatically saves every file, so if you don't change the file name or directory, your files will be saved in someone else's folder. And lastly, never image steps taller than 7.5 microns. After finishing your measurements, be sure to bring the stage all the way forward. Close vacuum valves and remove your sample. Remove your probe. Close the software, close and lock the acoustic enclosure, and of course, disable the tool. In this part, we'll discuss some basic troubleshooting and finding the more advanced modes on the tool. The most common issue is a dull, broken, or contaminated tip. This happens to all tips eventually. You can see in this image how the profile is distorted due to the particle on the tip and how that distortion repeats throughout the AFM image. So let's look at some example images from Nanolab's Park AFM. The top two images are from sample one. The bottom two images are from sample two. Which images show a bad tip? The left images have a bad tip. The bottom left image shows this candy corn shape over and over. It's less clear that the top left image is bad. However, you can see the same structure repeating, and it gets bigger with bigger features, suggesting that the tip shape is distorting the image. For both samples, the right images were produced immediately after exchanging probes, giving the true topography of the sample. Another common issue is trouble finding the laser. First, check that the laser is on. The intensity usually shows a negative value if the laser is off. Second, try turning the microscope light way down. Although this makes the cantilever harder to see, it does improve the visibility of the laser. The final issue we'll cover here has to do with mounting your sample. We don't recommend using tape to mount your sample, as the system vacuum is usually sufficient. But there are cases where it is necessary to mount a sample to a sample holder. Tape and glues need time to relax after being applied, or it is possible to observe shifting in the sample. Remember to never apply tape directly to the AFM stage Doing so is grounds for disqualification. Finally, we'll discuss the advanced measurement modes on our Park AFM tool. You need 5 hours of tool use using standard topography measurements before staff will train you on advanced measurements. Advanced measurements are more complicated, and you will need a solid understanding of the basics before attempting them. Here you can see measurement modes separated into contact and non-contact categories. Recall that you can measure topography either in contact or non-contact mode, non-contact mode being the default. In contact mode, you can also image the piezo-responsive material called EFMDC on our tool. You can measure the stickiness of a substrate with force modulation microscopy, and you can use approach spectroscopy to measure multiple sample properties at any given point. Finally, it is possible to apply a current and measure voltage using conductive probe AFM. Non-contact advanced modes include electrostatic force microscopy, EFM, scanning Kelvin probe microscopy, SKPM, and magnetic force microscopy, MFM. Nanolab does not stock probes for any of these advanced modes. Discuss with staff to find the correct probe for these techniques prior to requesting training. I'm now going to describe a couple of these advanced modes. MFM can measure magnetic domains across a sample. On the forward trace, the probe measures topography. On the backward trace, the probe is lifted a set distance above the surface. Deviations on the second trace are then due to magnetic forces acting on the probe. Force modulation microscopy measures stickiness. This is a contact measurement where a slow oscillation is applied. Recall that contact measurements usually don't oscillate the tip. By looking at the phase and amplitude signals, you can infer information about the relative stiffness of the sample. EFM generally refers to three different measurements. EFM, a non-contact measurement of electrical potential. SKPM, which can measure a sample's work function. And DC-EFM, which measures the piezo response of a sample. Lastly, there is conductive probe AFM, which allows the tool to apply a current to the sample while mapping topography. This is the end of AFM class. To get credit for watching this video, please take the AFM class test online.